Yo, what's good, everybody? It's your boy Malcolm, and I'm back for another video. And in today's video, we are going to be ranking all of the villains in the Avatar franchise. Yes, that is The Last Airbender and Legend of Korra. We're going to be ranking them all. This is going to be a good one, so get ready. Avatar is one of those series where everybody has an opinion on it because it is probably the greatest franchise of all time when it comes down to cartoons. So everyone has their own feelings and individual opinions on it. So before I even get into the list, make sure you guys go down in the comment section and let me know who you guys feel is number one before you even see mine. Put who you guys think is going to be number one. While you're down there leaving your comment, make sure you guys subscribe, like, and hit that noti bell. If we can get this video to 100 likes, I'll drop another Avatar video next week. And if you want more nerd content from me, I also have a podcast where me and two of the bros talk about all things anime and nerdy for about 2 hours every single week. You don't want to miss it. But all right, let's get into this list. Now, between the two series, there are a lot of incredible characters and a lot of incredible villains. So I have taken the time, I've put in hours into this, to compile a list of all of the main villains and rank them based on a couple different criteria, which I'm gonna tell you guys right now. First off is their power. How strong were they? Two is their accomplishments. What did they accomplish and how close were they to getting to their end goal? Because as we know, they're villains and villains gotta get beat by the hero. So most of them probably never hit their end goal, but how close did they get to it? Three is their challenge. How much of a challenge were they to the main character, not just physically, but also mentally? A challenge is a challenge. Four is their impact. How crucial was the villain's role in pushing the story forward? Five is character development. How developed were they in their motivations, their backstory, their personality? This is very important for a villain because without character development, we don't really get attached to that villain. We can't really feel what they're feeling and the emotion isn't really there. So this is a very important one. And last but not least, six. How memorable were they as a villain? When we look on Avatar, do we think about this villain as one of the greats? Do we remember the things that they do, how we felt when they were on the screen? So now that we got the criteria down, we are going to go through all of the main villains. And when I say main villains, I'm trying to say like big villains that had an actual impact on the season and were there for a good amount of time. And I did my best to kind of group these up because some of them could be separated individually, like Long Fang could be one and the Dai Li could be another one, but I tried to combine them. Same with like Azula, Ty Lee, and Mei. Those kind of all fall under Azula, so I tried to package them the best I could. But now that we got the criteria down, let's go ahead and get into it. In 10th place, we have Combustion Man. Combustion Man, also known as Sparky Sparky Boom Man, is a silent and deadly assassin hired by Zuko in an attempt to kill Aang. He possesses a rare and dangerous firebending ability known as combustion bending, which allows him to create powerful explosions from a third eye tattoo on his forehead. Even though he was dangerous as hell and had formidable skills, he was ultimately defeated by my boy Sokka during an intense battle in the Western Air Temple. Look, I love Sparky Sparky Boom Man. I think he's cool as hell. But yeah, he had to go in the last place position. He ranks last in almost every single category. Power is probably where he does best because combustion bending is OP as hell, and he's one of two people that we ever saw do it. But as far as his accomplishments go, he accomplished absolutely nothing. He literally had one job, and that was to get Aang, and he never did it. He was very annoying, and I guess he slowed them down a bit, but he has no accomplishments to show for it. As far as posing a challenge to the group, he was kind of challenging, but once again, he never really did much to them. He had absolutely no character development, which rightfully so. He's supposed to be a silent assassin, so it would be kind of crazy if he had a bunch of development. And I mean, as a minor villain in Hired Gun, he really didn't have much impact on the plot. Now, I will say, he was pretty memorable as a villain. When we think about the series, Sparky Sparky Boom Man do pop up in your head. But that's probably more so because of Sokka giving him a fire name. Outside of that, yeah, he definitely deserves to be in this last place position. There's no villains that are worse than him. In 9th place, we have Admiral Zhao. Admiral Zhao was a high-ranking officer in the Fire Nation Navy, known for his arrogance and ambition. He becomes a significant villain early in the Avatar The Last Airbender days, and he was obsessed with capturing Aang in order to attain glory. His most infamous act is his attempt to destroy the Moon Spirit, which would have extinguished all waterbending abilities. Even though he briefly succeeded, his actions were quickly reversed and he was eventually smoked by the Ocean Spirit. If you kill the Moon Spirit, the Ocean Spirit gotta get they get back. Even though he is very low on this list, Admiral Zhao was a good villain. I feel like the reason he's here is because he was so early in the season. So things only really had time to grow and progress from him. But he was a good starter villain. As far as his power goes, he was a skilled firebender, but he wasn't as good as a lot of the other benders we meet later in the series. But when it comes down to accomplishments, he had some good ones. My boy killed the moon spirit. That is a huge accomplishment. If it wasn't for the fact that Aang is the main character, he won. Waterbending got absolutely eliminated. That shit was crazy. And not only did he kill the moon spirit, he also destroyed all record of the firebenders in Wan Shi Tong's library. Admiral Zhao was a demon. As far as challenge goes, he was a persistent threat to not only Aang, but also Zuko for the early parts of the series. As far as impact goes, his actions did lead to pretty significant consequences, but in the end, I feel like he kind of ended up just being a stepping stone for bigger threats later down the line. Character development, he was a power-hungry, arrogant character with not that much development, but still pretty good. As far as his memorability, I feel like he's mostly remembered by his arrogance and his final moments where he wouldn't let Zuko save him in the end. Zhao was a good villain, but it just got so much better from there on. All right, in eighth place, we got Long Fang and the Dai Li. Long Fang was the manipulative leader of the Dai Li and the head of the city's political affairs. As a skilled earthbender, Long Fang used his power and influence to control the Earth King and suppress information about the war. He also served as a significant obstacle to Team Avatar, maintaining the facade of Ba Sing Se as an untouched sanctuary while hiding the truth of the Fire Nation's advances. His reign ended when Azula snaked him for his power, his squad, and eventually led to his downfall. I'ma keep it all the way real with y'all. If this list was based solely on my emotions, Long Fang would be in dead last. I feel like he is the most bitch made whole character in all of Avatar. Like, he was just so slimy and grimy, and then to see Azula go to snake him and he just bows down and lets it rock. I don't rock with Long Fang, man. When it comes down to his power, he wasn't really very significant as a bender, but he had a lot of political power and influence. But if we're talking about his accomplishments, he did a pretty good job. He controlled Ba Sing Se and the Earth King through fear and manipulation for years. Not only that, but he held Appa down for a while too. It was a huge challenge to Team Avatar because he was a significant obstacle in their efforts to reveal the truth about the war to all the citizens of Ba Sing Se and the Earth King. Not only did he have a heavy impact on the plot of season 2, him and the Dai Li damn near were the plot of season 2. As far as character development goes, he was a cunning politician, but he wasn't too much deeper than that. I mean, he did have a lot of hoe deep down once we learn later, but he wasn't that deep of a character. But he does rank rather low for memorability because while he was doing a lot when he was on the screen, the way that Azula snaked him at the end kind of just took everything away from him. I feel like when we think about season 2, even though he was the main villain for most of it, Azula kind of sticks in our head. I hate Long Fang and I feel like he should have been last, but when we're looking at this objectively, the 7th place position is probably the best place for him. In the 7th place position, we got the Great Uniter, Kuvira. Kuvira was a former disciple of Su Yin Beifong and a highly skilled metalbender. She became a dictator after uniting the fractured Earth Kingdom by force, declaring herself as the Great Uniter. She's also known for her military prowess, strategic mind, and creation of a mastered spirit-powered Megazord. Her campaign to conquer Republic City led to a climactic final battle with Korra, where she was ultimately defeated and made to face the consequences of her authoritarian actions. Kuvira gets a lot of hate, but I loved her. I feel like she was a really, really good villain. The only reason she's so low on this list is because there's a lot of better villains than her, but I loved her. I thought she was perfect. As far as her power goes, she was an incredible military strategist and one of the best metal benders we've seen. We cannot forget, she went toe-to-toe with the Beifongs and was getting that shit done. Her accomplishments speak for themselves. She united the Earth Kingdom by force and built a massive army and a gigantic Megazord powered by spirit vines. She was an absolute demon. I also feel like she posed a really big challenge to Korra, not just physically, but also philosophically. She forced Korra to kind of face the consequences of her actions, deal with a lot of trauma that she had left over from the season before, and taught her a lot about what it meant to really be a leader. And she beat her ass a couple times, so that definitely goes in the challenge category. I also feel like Kuvira ranks very high in the character development aspect, as do a lot of Korra's villains. I feel like Korra's villains were way more developed when it comes down to personality and just development overall, because Kuvira was motivated by a desire for order, but that kind of got twisted up into a tyrannical authoritarian type of view, which turned her into the villain, even though her goal was to be the good guy. While she did have a huge impact on the plot that probably would have been long lasting for seasons to come, it was the final season, so we couldn't feel the full amount of the impact, but she did have a very big impact on the entire last season of Legend of Korra, and I'm sure later on she had impact as well. As far as memorability goes, I feel like you could argue that she's the least memorable out of all the villains in the Legends of Korra, but she is more memorable than some of the characters mentioned before in Avatar The Last Airbender. Overall, a great villain. She put in work. She caused a lot of struggle. I think she did her thing, but the seventh place position is as far as I could put her. In sixth place, it's my boy Prince Zuko. Zuko is the conflicted prince of the Fire Nation, son of Fire Lord Ozai and older brother to Azula. Initially driven by desire to restore his honor by capturing the Avatar, Zuko's journey is one of redemption and self-discovery. Though he wasn't as naturally gifted as his sister, Zuko becomes a very powerful firebender through rigorous training, eventually learning to redirect lightning. So Zuko was actually a very tough one to place on the list, because when we're making a list of villains, you gotta put Zuko on there, but he does get sold kind of short on this one because he turns into a good guy. So we don't have a ton of stuff to go on, and we're missing out on all the best parts of Zuko in this ranking, but that's kind of where he deserves to be because he was a villain, but his heart was never in it for real. First, let's talk about his power. Zuko is a highly skilled firebender, and while he's not as naturally gifted as Azula, he became powerful through rigorous training and determination. Not to mention, he put a lot of focus on his martial arts skills, like using the swords and just hand-to-hand combat. So where he lacked in firebending, he picked up in those areas. As a villain, he also got some pretty decent accomplishments. Zuko briefly captured Aang on a couple different occasions. Yes, Aang always ended up getting free afterwards, but Zuko did catch him slipping a couple different times. And he also helped overthrow the Dai Li at the end of season 2. Now, one of his best ranking categories is his challenge. While Zuko's power isn't very high, he presented a significant challenge to Aang and his friends, especially in the first two seasons. His persistence and resourcefulness made him a consistent and constant threat. Although he never really defeated Aang outright, just his presence always caused him to be on high alert and forced them to consistently get stronger and better. Also, we gotta talk about his character development, debatably one of the most important categories in this list. Now, even though a lot of Zuko's character development lied in season 3, where he switched from being a hero to a villain, he still was a very deep character before that, because even though he was a villain, being driven by his quest for honor and blah 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 whatever, we always knew that deep down Zuko was a good guy, and on multiple occasions we saw him fight with that and be conflicted with that. Even as a little kid, before I knew he was gonna be a good guy, I was still rooting for Zuko because I knew he had that good in him. You could argue that he had one of the biggest impacts on the plot than any other villain. He literally was the driving force for most of it. And we don't even have to talk about his memorability. Zuko is debatably the most memorable villain of the entire series. If he would have stayed a villain the entire time, it would have been a huge disservice to him, but yeah, he probably could have gotten way higher up on the list, but he wasn't a villain the whole time. But when he was a villain, he did it goddamn well. To be honest with you guys, number 3 and number 4 are damn near interchangeable. I tried really hard to decide which one goes where. I'm gonna do it in this order, but like, if you don't agree, I'm not mad at you, because these are really hard. In the 5th place position, I'm gonna put Unalaq / Vatu as the Dark Avatar. Unalaq was the Northern Water Tribe's chief and the uncle to Avatar Korra. He was a master waterbender and spiritual leader. He seeked to merge the physical and spiritual world, but was ultimately driven by a desire for power. He became the Dark Avatar after merging with Vatu, the spirit of chaos and darkness, in an attempt to plunge the world into an era of darkness. His actions led to a major conflict between the spirits, humans, fundamentally altering the balance of the world and taking away all of Avatar Korra's past lives. If there is one thing that Una Vatu had, it was power. There really isn't a debate against the fact that this was the most powerful villain that we saw in all of Avatar. We know that the Avatar is the most powerful force in the world, and this was the dark version of that, literally just as strong. Actually, at the time of Harmonic Convergence, I think he was actually stronger. He had crazy accomplishments, a lot of which never got reversed. A lot of villains in the series, they would accomplish something and then it would get fixed. His shit never really got fixed. He opened the spirit portals, merging the human and spirit worlds forever, and he permanently deleted all the past lives of the Avatar. That might be the greatest accomplishment we've seen. I mean, I guess the one that did get reversed was he became the Dark Avatar, but not for that long. So yeah, that one technically got reversed, but for the most part, he was holding that shit down. He posed a tremendous challenge to Korra, not only physically as the Dark Avatar, but also philosophically and spiritually. He pushed her in ways spiritually that no other character ever really did. And he's her uncle, so this shit pushed her whole family boundaries. It messed with her bond with her dad, her whole self-worth, trusting herself. Like, Una Vatu was really fucking shit up. His character development was nuts. On one half, he was this kind, loving uncle. On the other half, he was this evil-spirited dark avatar. Nobody was really prepared for that 180 that was coming and hitting us. Very prevalent impact on the plot. His actions fundamentally changed the world's spiritual landscape and left a long-lasting effect on Korra. Surprisingly, he does rank kinda low in the memorability, which is crazy because I feel like he did so much and was such a crazy villain. But we have some crazy ass villains in the Legends of Korra that I feel like he just didn't make the cut, but he is goated. Unalaq was goated, but we got bigger goats coming next. In the fourth place position, I feel like this positioning is gonna cause some controversy, but we got Fire Lord Ozai. Fire Lord Ozai was the tyrannical ruler of the Fire Nation and father of Zuko and Azula. Known for his ruthless ambition and desire for power, Ozai sought to conquer the world and reshape it under the Fire Nation's rule. He was considered one of the most powerful firebenders of his time, especially during the period of Sozin's Comet, which greatly enhanced his bending abilities. Despite his immense power, his reign ultimately ended in defeat when Aang stripped him of his bending, bringing the end to the Hundred Year War. Now I know that everybody likes to hype Ozai up and say that he's one of the most goated villains, and he is one of the most goated, but he is also probably one of the most overrated people in the entire Avatar franchise. Because Ozai was a very scary dude, and he put that fear in Aang and everybody else, but we never really saw him do much, which you could argue in some ways made him a really good villain because just the fear of him was so powerful. But I feel like there are villains on this list that really got down to business and made shit happen and were consistently causing that fear and chaos and commotion on a level that Fire Lord Ozai just didn't do. I mean, shit, at the end of the day, I don't even think we saw Ozai until the final season. But let's talk about his stats and accolades. Ozai got a lot of power. He is definitely one of the most powerful firebenders of all time, especially during Sozin's Comet. It's hard to say he's the most powerful firebender of all time because we only saw him bend on the strongest day of history, so we couldn't really see how strong he was on a normal day, but he's definitely up there. He has some good accomplishments. He nearly succeeded in conquering the world. As far as his challenge goes, you could argue that he's the final and most formidable challenge for Aang. Although to an extent he was a physical threat for Aang, he posed a bigger psychological threat and challenge for Aang because Aang is strong and he did have the power to beat Fire Lord Ozai. But where the real challenge came was the fact that he could not kill him. He had to go and go on this journey and meet the Lion Turtles and do all this in order to find out he could take away his bending. That was the real challenge there. Psychologically, Ozai was fucking Aang up. And I'm not gonna sit here and pretend like he wasn't strong. He was very strong, but as we saw, once Aang got into the Avatar state and got that shit popping, it was really over. And some people say that he didn't even truly need the Avatar state to beat Ozai. He was just too scared to do it without it. His character development is nearly a zero. All the character development we get from Ozai is mostly seen through his kids. We kind of see who Ozai is through the way Azula acts and the way that Zuko acts, but we rarely ever see Ozai do much himself. His impact on the plot is absolutely undeniable. He was the main villain of the entire Avatar The Last Airbender series. From episode 1 to the last episode, all we were thinking about is, how is Aang going to beat the Fire Lord? And memorability, he got it in spades. He literally was the main villain of the entire first series. Ozai is goated, and I know it sounds like I'm hating, but there are so many villains that were way more hands-on and actually did more and made us feel things and fear things in a way that Ozai just wasn't able to do. He did it in a really good, mysterious way, but there are a lot of better, in-your-face, well-developed villains in the Avatar series. All right, let's get down to the top three. In the third place position, we got Aman. Aman, born Noatak, is the charismatic leader of the Equalists, a movement dedicated to ending the oppression of non-benders. Aman was secretly a waterbender with the rare ability to bloodbend without a full moon, which he uses to block other benders' abilities, making them powerless. His actions sparked a significant revolution in Republic City, leading to widespread fear and unrest. His true identity and tragic backstory are revealed in the climactic moments of his confrontation with Avatar Korra. Before we say anything else, I just gotta say it. Aman was an absolute demon. For him to be the first big villain that Korra had to deal with is insane. This man had political power, physical power. This man was a threat all the way through. But let's talk about his stats and accolades. His power was ridiculous. He was a skilled waterbender and bloodbender, being able to take away people's bending abilities forever. And not only did he have physical power, but he also possessed a wild amount of political power. And this man accomplished a lot. He led a major revolution against benders, stole the bending away from a lot of prominent benders in the community. And even after the Equalist movement was over, he caused long-lasting disdain and distrust of benders by regular people. He posed a significant challenge for Korra. He caused her to question her identity as the Avatar, as well as stripping her away from all of her elements outside of air. Aang did end up giving her these back later, but to take away three of the bending styles from the Avatar, that is not easy to do, and it is absolutely fucking insane. Aman had a very deep and tragic backstory with his brother Tarlok, which added even more depth to his motivations as Aman. I feel like his impact on the plot kind of speaks for itself, being the main driving force of the entire first season of Legends of Korra. But his revolution had a long-lasting impact on Republic City's politics and the public perception of bending. A lot of the political events that took place in seasons 2, 3, and 4 all to an extent stemmed off from what happened in season 1. And Aman is one of the most goddamn memorable villains we have in the entire series. This man was scary and bone-chilling. Not to mention, he was an effective-ass antagonist, and that final twist is also going to stick in our heads for forever. I am so sad that Tarlok had to take him out at the end, because that was a crazy-ass villain. Like, what a well-written villain. The writers went crazy with him. But what's even crazier is, even though Aman was the GOAT, we still got two people better than him. In the second place position, we have the one who entered the void, Zaheer. After gaining the ability to airbend, Zaheer quickly mastered the art, eventually learning to fly, a feat thought impossible by most. His philosophical beliefs and extreme methods make him a formidable opponent to Korra. Zaheer's actions led to the fall of the Earth Kingdom and the near death of Korra, leaving her physically and psychologically scarred and traumatized for a long time. This man Zaheer was a beast, and we saw how much he accomplished once he got his airbending abilities, and it makes you think, how dangerous was this man before he got his airbending? They had to lock him up on an island all by himself, make him face the wall, and bring multiple guards just to give him a meal with no bending. How crazy was he before he got this airbending? There are rumors that the reason why people treated Zaheer like this, like he was such a danger, is because he was actually the one who killed Sokka. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but that's what a lot of people say. But let's go ahead and get into his stats and accolades. His power was very immense. This man learned the principles of airbending extremely fast and became one of the best airbenders we had. Now, I'm not going to call him a master because we saw what happened when he went toe-to-toe with a real master. Shout out my boy Tenzin. But he was up there. And we can't forget this man unlocked the ability to fly, which only one other person in recorded history had done before him. Shout out Guru Lahima. His accomplishment list is nuts. He broke out of jail, broke his whole gang out of jail, destabilized the Earth Kingdom, killed the Earth Queen, and almost killed Korra. He did all that shit in like the matter of a week. He was going stupid. Him and the Red Lotus were a tremendous challenge to Korra, not only physically, but also mentally. Their physical, spiritual, mental, philosophical battles left her scarred and traumatized for years and years and years to come. He was also a master strategist and was posing a challenge at every step they took. Every time that you think you get the one up on Zaheer, he's one step ahead of you, already figuring out what the next play is. Realistically, they only really beat him with the power of friendship at the end. He deserved to win. Let's just keep it a stack. He's probably one of the most developed villains we have in the entire franchise. Being an idealist with a very complex philosophy, believing in absolute freedom through chaos. It's interesting because he does a lot of bad and fucked up shit, but he never really was a bad guy at his core. It had a very long-lasting impact on the plot. His actions led to the rise of Kuvira and further turmoil in the world. The trauma he caused Korra was a major driving force in all of Season 4. And his memorability was through the roof. He's easily one of the most philosophically engaging villains. And when you think about villains in The Legends of Korra, you're probably going to think about Zaheer first. That boy was different. I almost fucked around and put Zaheer number one, but there is one villain that deserves this spot more than anybody else. And I'm sure you guys probably feel the same way about this. It is Princess Azula. Azula was the gifted princess of the Fire Nation and younger sister of Prince Zuko. She was a master firebender and is particularly known for her blue fire and her ability to generate and manipulate lightning, a rare and advanced firebending technique. She was cold, calculating, highly intelligent, and was a formidable strategist who nearly succeeded in capturing the Avatar and conquering Ba Sing Se, one of the most fortified cities in the entire world. Her relentless pursuit for power and perfection eventually led to her psychological unraveling, culminating in a tragic downfall. Before we go any further, I want to get one thing straight. The person who ended up beating Azula in the end was Azula. If she didn't go crazy, I really don't know how this story would have ended up. Zuko might have ended up getting smoked. Katara might end up. I don't know what the fuck would have ended up happening. Azula was a real demon, and her own unraveling is what kind of saved the world at the end of the day. As far as her power goes, she was an absolute prodigy of firebending. If you stop and look through the feats of all the firebenders throughout the series, she has the greatest feats. You could make the argument that she is the greatest firebender that we've seen. As a 14-year-old, her list of accomplishments is also insane. She captured Ba Sing Se, killed the Avatar, and became Fire Lord all before she turned 15. She's debatably the character that provided the most challenge for Team Avatar throughout the entire series. She was consistently outmaneuvering them, outplaying them, outstrategizing them, and just getting it done in ways that they couldn't even handle. She became a damn near insurmountable challenge. From the moment she got introduced in the story, she was one of the most central points in Aang's development and Zuko's development and redemption. Not to mention, she was a huge driving plot point for seasons 2 and 3. And let's talk about her character development because the writers went absolutely crazy. She was the perfect, poised, gifted kid that got everything done, got everything she wanted, and never messed up. And then we slowly watched her descent as her mental state started to decline. She started to get more crazy and things started not going her way. And we find out more about her past with her dad and her mom and her brother. If we're talking about development, Azula got it in spades. Outside of Prince Zuko, she might be the most well-developed villain we got throughout the entire Avatar franchise. And let's just keep it a bean. She is probably the most iconic villain throughout the entire franchise, if not the most iconic villain of the entire franchise. Azula was an absolute beast. She was getting it done. Everybody was scared of her. I can't see a world in which Azula does not deserve the number one position for best villain of the Avatar franchise. She killed it and she was an absolute demon. Let me know what you guys thought of the list in the comments. Let me know if y'all ended up guessing right who the final person was gonna be. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you haven't done so already, like, share, comment, subscribe, and I'll catch you guys in the next one. I'm out. Peace.